Chapter 9. We moved into the house as if we were simply guardians of the land, and required of ourselves to preserve as much as we could. This orchard was planted by Mate, and thus gave us a connection to him, a link to the man whose house we now occupy. Stepping into the orchard was like entering another world. A feeling increased by having to duck under an old apple tree that miraculously still bore fruit. By all accounts, he was a good, hard-working man, and echoes of him still reverberate through the rooms. Much of his farming equipment still languished in overgrown corners. Buried beneath years of grass, a harrow lay rotting. It had a heavy wooden frame tapering to half the width at the end that was hitched up to the oxen. Cross beams were studded with metal spikes, which would break up the clods as it was dragged over the furrows. Elsewhere I found a wooden harness beautifully crafted and adjustable to fit over any head. Inside the house, we set about the repairs and decorating. While the walls over the years had become somewhat dull and grubby, we kept a small patch to show the original decorative design. It was quite a skill to employ this method for adding decoration to the lime-washed walls. Rollers with a decorative pattern were attached to a handle with a paint trough, which were then rolled up from the bottom of the skirting to the top, leaving a repeated design in their wake. Mate had used alternative patterns to make the overall effect a little more adventurous. This method of wall decoration was known as Wolzania, and in my walks around the village I copied down several different designs, usually taken from abandoned houses. Having repaired the walls where the plaster had come away and painted them, we undertook to bring water into the house and install a bathroom with a shower. The bathroom had previously been some kind of storage room with steps leading up to the attic. The traditional method was to dig a rainwater tank and attach an outdoor manual pump, but we installed an electric pump and the necessary pipework to ensure that we never need venture outside for water for washing. In the village there are two principal sources of water, that which falls from the sky filling cisterns, and that which percolates through the ground and is filtered through rock. Along the village road one may come across a well or a dew pond, but many of these have outlived their function as a watering hole for cattle, going to and returning from pasture. With changes in agricultural practices over the years, there is no longer any livestock to take to the field, and this has led to these roadside dew ponds becoming neglected. They have become silted up with leaves, some have even been filled in and all traces eradicated. But watering cattle was not the only function why these dew ponds were important. That was a large dew pond by Mladen's, but now it's filled in. It's a pity. Oh, what is the point of keeping them when there isn't any cattle? But what would happen if you have a fire and the firemen needed water? There are those, too, that dry up in summer and are only replenished when the autumn rains fall. But for drinking water, there are the natural springs. These are even fewer and far between. At either end of the village, springs can be found sunk into clefts between fields. The water merely trickles, and before the villagers enclose them, they would have to wait hours patiently for their vessels to fill up. The building of concrete troughs to collect water subsequently had a tremendous impact and improved the lives of everyone. Of course, people still use the springs. When it is dry like this, everyone went to the source, the whole village. Before it was enclosed, I'd wait ages to fill my bucket. If there were many people and I couldn't wait, I'd go to another source, which was quite far and the road was fairly hilly. I'd carry my bucket home on my head. I was much younger then and could carry 20 litres. I doubt I could even carry 5 litres these days. By far the most intriguing spring can be found in the next village of Lukatici. far away from any homestead. 22 beautifully carved steps lead one down into a natural chamber. Inside there is no light with which to see the water, only hear it, trickling into a pond somewhere in the dark. As the walls of the cavern taper inwards, one needs to feel one's way to the edge of the pool and stoop down with a bottle in hand. Here, as elsewhere, after rainy days, the water becomes tainted with the taste of earth. However, in times of drought or when the demands of the family exceed the amount of rainfall, there is always the third option, the river. When his water level becomes low, Drago hitches up a trailer to his tractor and heads off down to the Mrežnica. For those with a tractor and a pump, it is easy enough to fill large vessels and bring the water home. And on fine days, it is particularly pleasurable to sit on a tractor and view the village from a lofty height, and to travel at a speed akin to that of a horse trotting, and somehow feel a connection to a time when things move just a little bit slower. For many years, there has been talk of bringing mains water to the village. Stakes were even once pegged out along the specified route, but one suspects that with each death in the village, that day will never come, and we shall be required to continue to walk to one of the springs for precious drinking water. Within days of our arrival, we were known across the whole village. During the first weekend, we were entertaining a friend at the cafe in Zvečaj and tried to spot our house across the river from where we were seated. The waitress, while bringing our coffees, overheard our conversation and said, "That's your house over there." Of course, she was right.